Every Olympics, you see lists like this, tables showing the number of medals each nation has won. This is nice and simple, but the problem is that it actually doesn't tell you very much. A nation's size dramatically affects the number of medals it wins, so just adding them up is unfair to countries who don't have hundreds of millions or billions of people. So, which countries are really the best at the Olympics? The most common solution to the country size problem is to rank countries by medals as compared to population, or medals per capita. Supposedly, this corrects for size and gives every nation a fair shot. For instance, in the 2012 London Games, the United States finished first in total medals, but 49th in medals per capita. Grenada earned just one medal, but because it only has about 100,000 residents, it was first in medals per capita. This is definitely fairer than a simple tally, but there's still a problem. For the US to pull ahead of Grenada in this table, they would have to win over 2,800 medals, more than three times the number awarded in the entire Olympics. For China, it's even worse. They would have to win over 12,000. So while a simple medal tally is unfair to small countries, a medals per capita ranking makes it literally impossible for large countries to reach the top of the standings. There must be a better way than this. But after looking around, I couldn't find a ranking system that gives both large and small countries a fair shot. So I made one. It turns out that the key is not to measure medals or population, but probability. As an example, imagine a theoretical Olympic Games where there are six events. All the winners are from three nations. The red nation, which has 5% of the world's population, wins one gold. The blue nation, which has 12%, wins two golds. And the massive green nation, which has 30% of the world's population, wins three golds. Given this information, which nation did the best? Well, it depends. You could rank them according to total golds, in which case green would win, or golds per capita, in which case red would win. But let's put these two rankings on a graph. Here's total medals, and here's medals per capita, so up and to the right is good. Here's red, here's green, here's blue. Suddenly, it looks like blue did the best. Now, let's try calculating the odds that each nation would perform as well as they did. For example, green, with 30% of the world's population, would theoretically have a 30% chance of winning each event. So what are the odds that it would win no fewer than 3 out of 6 events? You could do these calculations by hand, but there's a mathematical formula called a cumulative binomial distribution, which produces the same result. Either way, it turns out that the answer is about 26%. Do the math for all three nations, and it turns out that the nation least likely to win as much as it did was blue. Blue, the middle sibling, too small to have much of a chance at winning the most golds, and too large to have a great shot at winning in the medals per capita table, is finally recognized by the cumulative binomial distribution. And more importantly, by this standard, all three nations had a shot at first place. If either red or green had earned one more gold medal, they would have taken the top spot. So what happens if we apply this concept to the real Olympics? Well, it gets a little more complicated. Numbers get larger, probabilities get way smaller, and you have three different medal colors to deal with. So this is the formula I came up with. Three cumulative binomial distributions, one for golds, one for golds plus silvers, and one for all medals. Those three numbers are transformed with a logarithm to make them manageable and then averaged to create one number which hopefully reflects each nation's Olympic success. The higher the number, the better. I call it the
impressiveness-o-meter.
With this formula, I calculated a score for every nation in the last 10 Olympics, and I found the results to be mildly surprising. So, without further ado, according to the impressiveness-o-meter, the overall leaders of the last 5 Winter and Summer Games are... Norway and Australia. I don't know about you, but that's not what I was expecting. In the Winter Olympics, Norway wins overall on the impressiveness-o-meter and in 4 of the last 5 individual games. Austria is second and is the only other nation to rank first in any Winter Games since 1998. After that, it's Canada, Germany, Switzerland, and the Netherlands. On the summer side, Australia holds first place, having won the first 3 Olympics of the 21st century, but Great Britain is hot on their heels, having won the last 2 summer games. The US rounds out the podium in 3rd, followed by Russia, though take their performance for what you will, given the doping violations. Then comes Cuba, Hungary, France, Jamaica, and New Zealand. If any of these results seem counterintuitive, here's that graph from earlier. Remember, this side is total medals, this side is medals per capita. Up and to the right is good. Here's the United States, here's New Zealand, Russia, Great Britain, and here's Australia. On the winter side, things get a little confusing, but the one thing that is clear is that Norway blows everyone else out of the water. And finally, here are the top 5 finishers for each of the last 10 Olympics, according to the impressiveness-o-meter. Note that only Germany and the Netherlands appear in the top 5 in both a summer and winter games. New Zealand is the smallest nation to appear in any top 5, with less than 5 million residents, and the United States is the largest to appear, with 323 million. The closest margin was in Turin, where only 4 more gold medals would have put Norway ahead of Austria. Norway, Austria, and Canada are in the top 5 in every winter games, while there's more movement in the summer games. Note, for instance, Great Britain's steep rise and Russia's slow decline. Of course, there are still a bunch of things the impressiveness-o-meter doesn't factor in. Should we adjust for home field advantage? Should team sports count more since there are more athletes competing? Should popular sports count more? What about sports that give out a ton of medals? Should nations get credit for athletes who train within their borders regardless of which nation they represent? Should countries be handicapped according to wealth or snowfall? In the end, there's never going to be a perfect way to measure Olympic success, but at the very least, I'd like to think that the impressiveness-o-meter might be one of our least worst options. Thanks for watching, and make sure to come back in a couple of weeks when I'll post a follow-up video with all the 2018 results from Pyeongchang.